Hello students, good morning. Myself Pushpendra Singh and we are going to start with the current affairs, daily current affairs. Today you will have the 4th of January 2021. Okay, and you should be studying your the current affairs for the various examinations like civil services examinations, and you should also read the Hindu newspaper for this. Okay, so prefer either the Hindu newspaper or Indian Express newspaper. Any of these newspaper you can refer. All right, I would suggest you to refer the Hindu newspaper, but Indian Express newspaper is also equally good for your preparation. All right, so let's begin with the today's lecture. Okay, so the first news which is appearing is regarding the banana grid, right? So banana, you know, banana, right? So it is related to the grid which is made up of banana. So the scientist at the council of sponsored and industrial research, that is CSIR, the National Institute for the Interdisciplinary Science and Technology, this is the institution which is located at Pappanamod, right? It is located in Kerala basically, which has made a new product, right? This new product is made up of the banana, and this new product, the institute is called it the banana grid or the granules, right? Just like you might have seen through right, some of the granules that are made up of, say, for any grain. So such type of granules are made up of banana. So this new product is basically developed from the new Nendran bananas, right? So these are the special varieties of the bananas which are available in the Kerala. So this institute, which comes under the CSIR or the Council of Scientific and Industrial Research, the institute name is the National Institute for the Interdisciplinary Science and Technology, which has developed this new product. Now, this new product, right, which resembles or which looks like almost like a rava, right? Rava, which is nothing but a broken wheat, okay? So when you say in terms of the ingredients, this, the banana grit is basically the good for health, right? So it is good for the health. It is good for making the wide varieties of the dishes also. So you can use this banana grit for making the wide varieties of the dishes, right? And this is also useful for the essential nutrient supplement also. This nutrient, for example, can be used for making upma, right? The upma is the food which is prepared in some of the southern India's states. So it can be used for preparing upma, right? You can make, or you can basically mix, right, with the banana powder, right, for making the porridge. You can also mix it with the milk, all right? You can also mix it with coconut milk, right? And you can mix it with the milk or coconut milk for the use of, you know, for a drink, or you can make it for a healthier drink, which you can basically drink as your daily routine. So it has the tremendous the applications. So either it can be used for making upma, it can be mixed with banana powder, it can be mixed with milk, it can be mixed with the coconut milk also. Okay, now why this, the concept was utilized? The concept was basically introduced to utilize the presence of this resistant starch which is available in the bananas. So the starch which is available in the banana, right, which is having some special qualities or some of the medical medicated qualities. For example, it would improve the gut health, right? So it will improve the gut health if you consume this resistant starch which is available in the bananas, which are also known as Nendran bananas. So the dishes basically which is prepared out of this Nendran banana grit, right, and its byproducts, you can see this would definitely improve the gut health. And the scientific community, which is also related to the institute, is discussing, right, the importance of these granules for making the health and well-being of the people, right? So which can be used for making varieties of the dishes also. All right, so this is basically the banana grit, which is developed by the scientists at CSIR NIST, right, in the Kerala. All right, so this is the banana grit, which is developed by the scientists. All right, so let's understand the second news, that is the trans fat. So what is, first of all, what is the trans fat? First of all, you must understand. Okay. So for understanding the trans fat, you must refer this figure, first of all. All right. So first of all, you must understand that trans fats are also known as the hydrogenated oils, right? So they are also partially hydrogenated oils. Now, these trans fats, you know, are created artificially, right? By adding the hydrogen into the vegetable oil, which basically we use during our day-to-day cooking. So if you add hydrogen to the liquid vegetable oil, you would ultimately making the trans fats. Now, why we use this trans fat, right? So we use this process that makes the fat more solid, okay? That lengthen the life of the fat, or the shell life of the fat. And that will definitely make, you know, it more suitable for, you know, different type of purpose, for example, frying or for other uses also. Right. So we use basically the hydrogenated oil, right, for our day-to-day work, right, which is basically made up of by adding hydrogen into liquid vegetable oil, okay, which we use in the day-to-day life. Now, what is the benefit of that one? Because that will ultimately improve the shell life of the vegetable oil, and it also lengthen, or it will also, you know, makes the fat more solid. But what is the weakness of this trans fat? The biggest weakness of the trans fat is they are more unhealthier, right? They are not good for the health, right? Because they are more healthier than, you know, unsaturated fats which we consume during the vegetable oil. So you have the concept called good cholesterol and the bad cholesterol, okay? The good cholesterol basically are also known as high density lipoproteins. They are also known as HDL. So these high density lipoproteins, what happens is they pick the excess cholesterol, right? Cholesterol is not good for the health. It basically, you know, lowers the body's, you know, the capacity to flow the, you know, the blood, or it will retard basically, you know, the artery's capacity to flow the blood, right? So this high density lipoprotein, which is also known as the good cholesterol, it basically picks up the excess amount of cholesterol which is present in our body, and it will definitely transport it back to the body's liver, right? And there it will be processed, and it will be removed out from the body. So so if you consume the trans fat more and more, that will definitely, you know, the lowers the body's capacity to have the good cholesterol, okay? So consuming the trans fat would lowers the body's HDL level, or that is high density lipoprotein or good cholesterol. So that is why the trans fats are not good for the body, because it definitely retard the body's capacity to have the high density lipoprotein or good cholesterol. But the trans fats increases the bad cholesterol. What is the bad cholesterol? It is low density lipoprotein. So this low density lipoprotein basically, you know, transport this cholesterol throughout the body. So when you transport this low density lipoproteins or this cholesterol throughout the body, what will happen? The body will basically, you know, or the blood will basically flow through the different type of, you know, arteries. So when the cholesterol also flows along with the body, along with, you know, this blood, so it will be definitely, you know, storing this cholesterol in the walls of your body arteries. So when it's stored in the walls of the body artery, what will happen? The arteries will become more and more narrower. They become more hardened, right? And ultimately the capacity of the arteries to flow the blood also will reduce. And what will happen if the capacity of the arteries to flow the blood also reduces? There will be more likelihood to have the heart attack or the stroke, right? So this trans fats are also one of the most important causating agent of the heart attack or the stroke, right, in the day-to-day life. So we should consume the less amount of trans fat, because it will certainly induce the low density lipoproteins, and it will certainly reduces the high density lipoprotein, which is also known as good cholesterol. Okay, now let's understand the news regarding the trans fat. Okay, so the news which is flashing is that the Food Safety and Standard Authority of India, which is also known as FSSAI, it is a regulator for the, you know, the food regulator. So which has capped the amount of trans fatty acids in the oils and the fats. to the 3% for 2021 and 2% for 2022. So it has basically certainly kept that certain amount of trans fatty acids should not be more than 3%, right? So in the oils or the fat, so you cannot have the trans fatty acids more than 3% of its the total quantity, right? And that will be there, right, for 2021, and it will be further reduced to 2% by 2022. Currently, the permissible limit for the trans fat in the oils and the fat is only 5%. So which has further reduced to 3% for 2021 and 2% for 2022. So this has basically made, or this has basically kept by the FSSAI, which is also known as the Food Safety Regulator or the Food Safety and Standard Authority of India, right? Which has amended the food safety and standard restrictions on the sale regulations, right? So by this amendment, it has fixed the amount of the trans fatty acid which can be mixed in the oil and the fat. Okay. Now let's understand about the FSSAI. So what is the FSSAI? So FSSAI, through the notification or through the amendment in these regulations, right, have led to, some sort of the consultation with the different stakeholders. Then only it has certainly, amended these regulations. So as per the revised regulations, which apply to, refined oils that we use, the vanaspati oils or the partially hydrogenated oils or the margarines or the bakery shortenings or other medium of the cooking, such as vegetable fats, right, and the mixed fat spreads. So it will be applicable to those, different type of varieties of oils which basically use this trans fat. Okay. And you must understand that in 2011 itself, the India was the first country, or India was basically the first passed regulation that set the trans fatty acids, the limit. So that trans fatty, the acids which was fixed in 2011, it was 10% only, right? Just further reduced to 5% in 2015. Now this 5% has further reduced to 3% in 2021. And it will be further reduced to just 2% in 2022. So, which means the scientific community is in the opinion that the trans fatty acids, which are not good for the health, because it will definitely retard the body's capacity to have the good cholesterol, and it will definitely increases the chances of having the bad cholesterol, which will definitely increases the chances of the heart related the problems in the with the citizens. So that is the only reason the FSSAI has reduced the amount of the trans fatty acids in the oils or in the vegetable oils, right, which was first introduced in 2011, and the limit was 10%, which was further reduced to just 5% in 2015, which has further reduced to just 3% in 2021, and it will be further reduced to just 2% in 2022. All right. So these are the trans fats. So as I told you, the trans fats are nothing but the partially hydrogenated oils, right? Which are created by adding the hydrogen into the liquid vegetable oil which we consume. Why we add this, the hydrogen into liquid vegetable oil? Because it will increases the fat content, or it will make fat more solid, and it will also lengthen the shelf life of the oil also. The biggest drawback here is that it will be more unhealthier than the regular unsaturated, the fat we use, right? Because it will enhance, the low density, lipoproteins, and it will definitely retard or reduces the high density lipoproteins. The high density lipoproteins are also known as good cholesterol, because it transport back the cholesterol which is present in our body, right, to back to the liver, where it can be processed and it can be removed. But low density lipoproteins do not process back to the liver, but it basically take it out to the arteries of the body, where it will build up on the walls of the arteries, and definitely it will retard the capacity of the artery to flow the blood, and it will increase the chances of the heart related problems in the people. So that is why the amount of the trans fat acids in the oil has been capped to further 3% in 2021 and to 2% in 2022. All right. So let's begin with the third news, which is Kempegowda International Airport HART. So first of all, you must understand, it is the Kempegowda International Airport, which is located right in the Karnataka, right? Karnataka is a state. So this Kempegowda International Airport, you must understand, it is the airport which is located in Bangalore, Karnataka. And there was no such halt for the Indian Railways. So this halt, which was basically constructed by the operator of Kempegowda International Airport, which is also known as the Bangalore International Airport Limited. So which has built this international airport halt. Now this has dedicated, and this has, you know, after building, this has been, you know, given back to the Indian Railways. Now Indian Railways will start operating the train services from the Bangalore city to this newly built Kempegowda International Airport halt, right? So it will be beneficial for the Indian Railway passengers who basically travel from the train from Bangalore, you know, the railway station, or from any part of the country to reach to the Kempegowda International you know, airport. So at that halt, they can basically get down and they can pick their, or they can basically easily can take their flight for further destinations. So this airport halt is basically, you know, used by the Indian Railways, and this has been built by the operator, which operates also the airport, which is also known as the Bangalore International Airport Limited, and it will be handed over to the Indian Railways for its operation. So you can see the Indian Railways or the Southwestern Railways has sent a proposal for electrification of this line from this stretch. So here you can see this is the halt station, and here you will have the airport. So you can use this railway connectivity, right? This is the railway line. So you can use this railway halt station for accessing this the airport. And these are basically some of the road lines which are shown by this black lines. All right. So this is just an overview of the figure which we are talking about. All right. Next, the National Meteorological Conclave. Okay. So this conclave is a congregation of the scientists, which basically belongs to the Council of Scientific and Industrial Research, as well as the National Physical Laboratory, New Delhi. So why this National Meteorological Conclave is going to be held? Because the laboratory, which is known as the National Physical Laboratory, which is located in New Delhi, has completed its 75th year, right? So since its inception, it has completed 75th year, right? So for celebrating this 75th year, the National Meteorological Conclave 2021 would be organized, and it would be organized by CSIR, which is known as the Council of Scientific and Industrial Research, under which this laboratory is coming, which is also known as the National Physical Laboratory. All right. And the inaugural address for this National Meteorological Conclave would be addressed by the Prime Minister Narendra Modi, and he would address the National Meteorological Conclave on the 4th of January 2021 through video conferencing only. All right. And the theme of this National Meteorological Conclave is for inclusive growth of the nation. All right. And the most important point to be noted here is from this National Meteorological Conclave is that through this video conferencing, he will also dedicate the National Atomic Timescale, right? And the Bharatiya Nirdeshak Dravya, to the nation. So these two, will be dedicated to the country, right? Through this, the delivering address from the Prime Minister Narendra Modi. And he would also lay the foundation for the National Environmental Standard Laboratory, right? Which would also be set up under the Council of Scientific and Industrial Research. So let's understand what is this National Atomic Timescale, Bharatiya Nirdeshak Dravya, and the National Environmental Standard Laboratory. All right. So the National Atomic Timescale basically generates the Indian standard time with an accuracy of 2.8 nanoseconds. Okay, so this time scale which we use basically would reflect the changes in the standard time, or changes in the Indian standard time, with the accuracy of 2.8 nanoseconds, because you must understand there are certain mechanisms which basically facilitate the changes in the time. So to get the accurate amount of the time, right, with Indian standard time is also most important, the pressing need. So this National Atomic Timescale, which use, you know, some scientific principles to get the accurate time or accurate Indian standard time to the level of 2.8 nanosecond, have been developed through the National Atomic Timescales. Okay. Next is Bharatiya Nirdeshak Drabya. So this is the Drabya or the liquid. So what is this Bharatiya Nirdeshak Drabya? So it will definitely, you know, support the testing and calibration of laboratories. For example, if you conduct the experiments in the laboratories, this Drabya would support those testing, and it will also used in the calibration of different, you know, experiment you perform in the laboratories, and it will also assure the quality in the laboratories, which is at par with the international standards. All right. And the third is National Environmental Standard Laboratory. Okay. So this National Environmental Standard Laboratory would basically, you know, is basically, you know, have certain set of the mechanism which will aid the self-reliance in the certification of ambient environment and industrial emissions monitoring equipment. It will have, you know, some sort of a, you know, monitoring of the industrial emissions and the ambient air quality emissions, which will be, you know, monitored through this National Environmental Standard Laboratory. All right. Let's move to the new news. So this is basically a poster which shows that the Prime Minister Narendra Modi to inaugurate the National Meteorological Conclave, and he is Dr. Harshvardhan, who is basically the minister, the Union Minister of Science and Technology, right? So he's also having the additional portfolio of the Health Ministry also. So he's having currently two portfolios, and you people knows about Prime Minister Narendra Modi also. All right. So let's move to the new news, that is Pong Dam. Okay. So this Pong Dam is first of all located in the Kangra district of Himachal Pradesh. All right. So recently it is in news because 1,400 migratory birds have died, right, due to the unexplained cause. So this was in the news because the death of 1,400 migratory birds, which is located in the Kangra district of Himachal Pradesh. So this Pong Dam is also known as Bees Dam because it is located on, you know, on the embankment which is built on the Bees River. All right. So embankment means you basically build a supportive structure which basically, you know, pound the amount of the water. So which is called the earth filled embankment dam. So which basically, you know, have some sort of a controlled environment in which you basically collect the large amount of the water. And this water will be used for the different purpose. For example, the purpose of this dam is basically for the agriculture, for the, you know, for making the electricity, right, for making the any other purpose also, for drinking water also, for tourist purpose also. So there may be many such benefits, but this earth-filled embankment is basically a control system where you will basically collect a large amount of water, and it is basically built on the Bees River. That is why it is also known as the Bees Dam, but the exact name is Pong Dam. Okay, this lake is created by the dam, which is known as the Maharana Pratap Sagar, right? So you must understand the dam is known as the Bees Dam, but the lake which is created by this dam is known as Maharana Pratap Sagar. This Maharana Pratap Sagar lake is also famous for the bird sanctuary. And the purpose, it is a multi-purpose project. So the purpose of the dam is for irrigation, hydroelectric power, or the tourist purpose also. This is the Pong Dam, which is located in the Kangra district of Himachal Pradesh. All right. Let's understand commercial establishments to operate 24/7 in the Karnataka. So this is the Karnataka's news. So but it has some significance because the Karnataka government has decided to open all shops and commercial establishments 24/7, 24 hours, right, under the provisions of Karnataka Shops and Commercial Establishment Act 1961. So the Karnataka government has amended this act 1961, which allowed the opening of all shops and the commercial establishment round the clock, right, all the days of the week, 24/7 for the next 3 years. That means the round the clock opening of the shops and the commercial establishment would be applicable for the next 3 years from today to January 2, 2024. So it will be applicable for the 3 years. All right. So this revision of the rules, which was made by the Labor Department of the Government of Karnataka, right, it will definitely help the business to recover, because due to the recent pandemic, or due to the recent COVID-19 pandemic, the huge financial loss have been taken place to those the business which is facing the lot of problems in terms of restarting those business. So it allowed, so that is why the Karnataka government has allowed those business to recover during these 3 periods and allowed 24/7 and all 7 days to open the business and all shops to be for the next 3 years, right? And you must understand there is some statutory limit that the rule only permits only those shops and the commercial establishment which employ 10 or more persons. So if those employment or if those employers which do not employ more than 10 or 10 employees, they can't open the shops and the the commercial establishment. Okay, and the period of the extension is for 3 years only. Okay, next, tampon tax. This is the very important. What is the tampon tax? Tampon tax is basically the tax which is applied on the women's sanitary products. जैसे वोमेन के नैपकिन आते हैं ना, सो उन पे जो टैक्स लगता है, ठीक है, सो वोमेन्स ऑल सैनिटरी प्रोडक्ट्स इफ यू अप्लाई द टैक्स दैट वी कॉल टैम्पन टैक्स. सो यू नो द यूके और यूनाइटेड किंगडम गवर्नमेंट हैज डिसाइडेड टू अबॉलिश 5% ऑफ वैल्यू एडेड टैक्स व्हिच वाज प्रीवियसली इम्पोज्ड ऑन द वोमेन्स सैनिटरी प्रोडक्ट्स व्हिच आर ऑफन नोन एज टैम्पन टैक्स. Now, by abolishing this 5% of VAT, which was applicable on the women's sanitary product, the UK has now joined those countries which has already eliminated this tax. For example, India has eliminated, Australia has eliminated, and Canada also has eliminated. All right. And this was a measure which is a part of wider UK government's effort to call end poverty and period poverty. So, which is also good for the women also, which will be, the cheaply available to those women which cannot afford those quality, sanitary products also. All right. And the Scotland is also the part of UK which has made a history by November 2020, which has become the first country in the world to make the period products free of cost. Right. So it has made this period product free of cost to those women who are in the need of having or these sanitary products. All right, so these are the some of the countries which have recently abolished this tampon tax. So Australia, India is also there, Kenya, US. In the US, only few states, for example, Connecticut, Florida, Illinois, Maryland, Massachusetts, Minnesota, New Jersey, New York, and Pennsylvania has abolished this tampon tax. Canada, Ireland, and Uganda also abolished. All right. And this is the women pay high tax rates for the period supply. For example, the tax rates on the feminine hygiene products, you can see Hungary imposed 27% of such, the tax. The Sweden imposed 25%, the Mexico 16%, Spain 10%, United States 10%, Iran 9%, Germany 7%, France 5.5%, Poland 5%, and UK 5%. But recently UK has abolished this one. Okay, so these are the some of the countries which basically are the tax free. All right, and India is also one among them. Okay, fine. So let's move. Gibraltar. Okay, so Gibraltar, you must understand what is a Gibraltar. So Gibraltar is a British overseas territory. What is a British overseas territory? So it is controlled by the British, but it is located in some other place. Right, so that is why it is known as British Overseas Territory. So you must understand, it is a self-governing, the territory which is also having some responsibility given to the UK or to the Britain. For example, the defense and the foreign relations, for these things, the responsibility lies to the British government. Otherwise, the other subject have been vested to the government of Gibraltar only, right? For the defense and the foreign relations, the responsibility lies to the British government. So before we proceed to this news, okay, let's understand what is a Gibraltar. Okay, so first let's understand the history of Gibraltar. So what happens is, in 1704, the Anglo-Dutch force captured this Gibraltar from the Spain. So it was initially ruled by the Spain, which was captured by Anglo-Dutch force in 1704, right? Then this territory was ceded to the Great Britain. That means from Anglo-Dutch forces, this territory was given to the Great Britain, right? Under the treaty called the Treaty of Utrecht in 1713, right? Now, this is the most strategically significant, you know, the location. Why it is most strategically significant location? Because almost half of the world's seaborne trade, right, that passes through the ships, passes through this Strait of Gibraltar, okay? And it is also most important tourist destination and also the cargo ship refueling center also. So it has the strategic aspect because most 50% of the seaborne trade passes through the strait. It has the tourism significance also, important tourist place, and it also the important center for cargo ship refueling also. So this is basically the Gibraltar, which was a part of the Spain and which was captured by the Anglo-Dutch forces, and it was subsequently given to the Britain, right, in 1713. Since then, it has been autonomously controlled by the Britain. So Britain has the control over this Gibraltar. So this is basically the Strait of Gibraltar, through which the trade, which passes through almost 50% of the maritime bound trade, basically passes through the Strait of Gibraltar. So it has the strategic significance also. Okay, so what is the news in the today's newspaper? So newspaper is, the news is, you know, the Brexit means it is, you know, the term which basically used for the UK, which is basically, you know, separating from the European Union, right? So it is known as Brexit. Brexit means a Britain exit, Britain exit. So we use basically Brexit term. So it is a transition. Why the transition? Because the time period of this exit have been fixed by the end of year of 2020. So year of 2020 end is already got over. So transition period is also got over. So this, on the eve of the new year, the Spain basically announced. So that's important, you know, the point here in the news that Spain announced that he has struck a deal with the UK to maintain a free movement to or from Gibraltar. Because you must understand, the Gibraltar is basically, initially was part of the Spain, but it is still lying adjacent to the Spain. And you must understand, to move those products, right, from Gibraltar is also good for the economic, you know, the benefit for the Spain also. Spain has stuck a deal with the UK because the Gibraltar is ultimately managed by the UK to maintain this free movement, right, of those goods from the Gibraltar. And you know, this officially would make the Gibraltar a part of Schengen zone. This Schengen zone is basically, you know, a free trade area, which would definitely follow the European Union rules, right? And that will ensure that a hard border does not separate it from rest of the Europe. All right. So you must understand, since the Britain has now exited from the European Union, right? But the Gibraltar, which has also made it part of the European Union, but it has officially been in the Schengen zone, which will definitely follow the European Union rules, and which would ensure that it does not separate from the rest of the Europe. And the Spain has made a deal with the UK to maintain this free movement of goods and services from the Gibraltar. All right. So this is the news which is also flashing regarding Gibraltar. Next news is related to the vaccine, which is also known as ZyCoV-D. So it is the India's first indigenously developed the DNA vaccine candidate against the coronavirus. So this is India's first indigenously developed DNA vaccine candidate, which is also known as the ZyCoV-D. The ZyCoV-D, which would be manufactured by the Zydus Cadila. Okay. It is the manufactured name, or it is, you know, the company name which basically manufactured this, the DNA vaccine candidate, which is also known as ZyCoV-D. And this ZyCoV-D has got, you know, the approval by the Drug Controller General of India for the conduct of phase 3 clinical trials. So it has basically gave the approval. Now you must understand, this candidate, which is also known as ZyCoV-D, have supported by the National Biopharma Mission, which is under aegis of the BIRAC and the Department of Biotechnology, Government of India. All right. And you must understand, Zydus Cadila has completed already the phase one and phase two clinical trials of this vaccine candidate. And more than 1,000 participants already participated. And the interim data basically indicated that the vaccine is safe and reliable. And it has caused the immunogenic, effects. And the three doses will be administered intradermally. It will be causing the safe, impact on, through this vaccine against the coronavirus. And it will be based on some recommendations of the subject expert committee, which would definitely review, this interim data. And DCGI has already accorded the permission for conducting of phase three clinical trials, right, which will involve more than 26,000 Indian participants. And based on this phase third clinical trials, it will be decided whether to launch this vaccine or not. All right. Second, next news is Kochi Mangaluru natural gas pipeline. Okay. So it is named at Kochi Mangaluru. That means this would carry a natural gas, right? It will be connecting the Kochi and the Mangaluru, right? And this pipeline would be dedicated, right, to the nation by Narendra Modi on 5th of January 2021. So this would be 450 kilometers long pipeline, and it will be built by the GAIL India Limited. All right, and it will have the capacity or the transportation capacity of 12 million metric standard cubic meters per day. So this much amount of the natural gas would be transported, right, through this 450 kilometers long pipeline, right, and it will be dedicated to India. And you must understand, it will carry the natural gas from terminal, which is also known as the liquefied natural gas regasification terminal, which is located at Kochi, Kerala. And it will be transporting this natural gas to Mangaluru, right? Ultimately, the name at Dakshina Kannada district, which is located in Karnataka. And it will definitely pass through the various districts of the Kerala. For example, Ernakulam, Thrissur, Palakkad, right? Malappuram, Kozhikode, Kannur, and Kasaragod districts, right? So it will pass to the different intermediate districts. And you must understand, by laying of this pipeline is, having the great engineering challenge, because this pipeline would have, would have to cross the different water bodies at more than 100 locations. So that would basically have some of the engineering challenge, but a special technique, which is also known as the horizontal directional drilling method, would be used. And that method would ensure that there is no such problem in the construction of this 450 kilometers long pipeline, which will definitely connect the Kochi to the Mangaluru, and that will transport, or that will basically send the natural gas from these two terminals. Right. So this is a schematic map you can see here, the long pipeline. All right. And this would connect these two stations. All right. So that's all for the today's news, dear. So we'll meet again tomorrow. So thank you very much for attending this today's session. Thank you very much.